WOLB Baltimore and WERQ FM HD3 Baltimore, celebrating Radio 1's 42nd anniversary.
Our Radio 1 family, our employees, their family members, our listeners, our viewers, our extended family.
And serving the African-American community for over 42 years.
The views and opinions of the guest and host you hear on 1010 WOLB
are not necessarily those of the staff and management of Radio 1, its sponsors, or advertisers.
A boy is born in hot damn Mississippi, surrounded by for what that ain't so pretty. His parents give him love and affection to keep him strong, moving in the right direction, living just enough for the city. His father works some days for 14 hours, and you can bet he barely makes a dollar. His mother goes scrub the floors for many, and you best believe she hardly gets a penny. Living just enough, just enough.
Good morning, good morning. It's 10:01 here on 1010 WOLB, and Larry Young sitting in for the very talented, very capable Frank, I would say Frank Mr. Carlton Douglas, and I'm here with his team. And good morning to each and everyone. Esquire, how are you?
I'm doing well this morning. Happy to be with you, Baltimore. If you need my services, again, I'm a procurement lawyer in Baltimore City. Spend most of my time trying to collect the money that the city owes you. My number is 410-547-8820.
And the Esquire name?
Robert.
There you go.
Dashiell.
The one that knows, and talented too. Good morning, lovely. How are you?
I'm doing well. Thank you. Glad to have you here today. I am Tehma Smith Wilson, and I'm an attorney and business owner out of Baltimore City. Some of the services that we offer include real estate planning and estate planning. So if you need to buy or sell your property, or to create or update your will or your deed, or to purchase your ground rent, please give us a call at 667-334-7242. And if you would like to join the conversation and cannot get through in the phone lines, please text your question or your comment to 667-334-7242. And last but not least, if you missed a broadcast, please feel free to check us out on YouTube. All you have to do is go to YouTube, type in Frank Conaway Senior Show, and all of our broadcasts will come up for you to listen to on your phone, your computer, or your television.
Very good. Thank you much. I'm happy to say that it's a joy to be in here this morning with you. We got a lineup this morning, and I can see y'all do not play. Y'all say we're going to start from the top, right? So we're going to get started with, I just saw her the other day, and I tell you the truth, she seems to me she just looks good.
Yeah.
Period. That's the best way I can say. Yeah. She looks good and very capable, and she was there for the Love Fest for Anthony McCartney. Well, I want to tell Anthony, I told him to listen in. It was a fantastic program, good brother. And but let me also let you know that Carlton will be back on next Friday. He is, of course, one of the state's foremost, and in my opinion, that he's handled all my family funeral businesses and the business of funeral directors. But he has asked me to sit in, and so I'll do the best I can here. But in the meantime, we have
Mayor Sheila Dixon, who I think is already on the line. She doesn't need any introduction, so let's just get with it. Madam Mayor, you here?
Morning. Good morning. Help us out here. What's got her?
Well, she's not.
Hello. We heard lowly. Madam Mayor?
Can you hear
now
me?
We yeah, can. Yeah, okay. Yeah. Thank you.
I said I'm on the line. I can hear y'all.
Now we can hear you, good lady. Good morning.
Okay. Good morning.
Good morning. How are you? As I said a moment ago, you don't need any introduction. So why don't we just begin, if I can, by having you tell us, give us your account of the state of the city. Why don't we just start with that?
So my account of the city of Baltimore, I have very mixed emotions about Baltimore. One, I love the city. We have every key ingredient to be successful. There are good things going on in the city, and then there are things that are very challenging. We already know that we've got to get a better handle on the crime, particularly with juveniles and guns and all the quality of life issues, car thefts, et cetera, et cetera. Our schools are horrendous. I'm very disappointed in the city and what's happened with our schools and what's happened with our young people, because that's, for me, the key ingredient to help an individual become successful in life, to realize that they have a path and that they can do other things and that they can get out of poverty or issues facing them. And I'm just really concerned with the amount of money that we're now going to have to put into the schools based on the current, what's the new plan? Because it changes every X amount of years, the current plan. I think they call it something else. But and I'm concerned. I work with the private sector. We have to deal with the city. And I heard Robert say that, you know, that's one of his expertise as an attorney, is trying to collect. He knows the frustration, me representing the Maryland Minority Contractors and other clients, getting them paid. I've had companies over the last 2 years who just threw their hands up and stopped doing business with the city as a result of almost losing their business. Damn. Quality of services that are not being provided. Our streets. Out the trash, the solid waste, the recycling. So, I mean, there are a lot of areas where I got some real concerns that I just can't get a handle on why we can't provide basic fundamental services. Last but not least, something that I don't think people recognize, but I guess being in public office for the number of years that I have been, it seems like our priorities right now, we seem to be more into being a government of promotion and entertainment than providing basic fundamental services.
What do you mean by that? Give me an example.
What I mean by that is, in the past, when we did AFRAM, when we did Artscape, when we did different events in the city, BOMA used to handle Artscape and other events. We would contract out AFRAM to the private sector. We were sure, you know, our support would be helping to raise money and helping to provide supplemental support. The city government is now doing all of this. Recreation and Parks maybe should have focused on, instead of handling Artscape, I mean AFRAM, they should have focused on making sure that they had the pools up and running, that the rec centers were operating. You know, and I know the average person probably doesn't recognize the fact that city government now is doing these things. Recreation Parks played a big role in AFRAM, where in the past we would contract it out. Sunday after during the Caribbean Festival, young ladies, because we walk and run Drew Hill Park, we've been doing it since COVID. People in the administration at Recreation and Parks was really filthy. We had to be at 7:30 in the morning. They were picking up trash. The payroll woman was out there, because I always stop and ask questions. So I'm like, I don't know where this connection is, and I get it. We want to do events. We want to have festivals. We want to have people come to the city. But I don't know. Maybe the way I'm thinking is not the way things should be.
Well, let's look a little bit at this whole issue of public safety. We know that's in the news for a number of reasons. Most recently, and it's, of course, it's the whole the shooting at Brooklyn section of the city, 30 people shot, I think, died. What on the in the matter of public safety, on the issue of public safety, what do you think needs to be? What's wrong with it, and what does it take to fix it?
So, I mean, I think the holistic approach that the current mayor is trying to do, looking at preventive measures, because you can't just look at it from a public safety, police, more police. Yeah, we need to get our numbers up to the sworn police. We now have a state's attorney that believes in people paying for the consequences. It appears as though, which was a real benefit during my administration, when we were able to get crime down to the lowest that it had been in 30 years by having a great partnership with the federal prosecutors and state and all. We're not going to arrest the way out of that. It's not about just locking up everybody. But we've got to look, go back and look at where we are failing. You know, Larry heard me the other day when I was at Anthony McCarthy's event about the health of our citizens. Mm. I don't care what people say, but mental health, physical health, spiritual health, all of these factors contribute to some of the decision on what's happening with crime that we're facing here in the city. And so all of these pieces have to be working hand in hand together. And we've got to do it in a way where it's not just for now based on who's in charge and the leadership, but we have to have this done consistently across the board and really change some of the mindset of what's going on. That Brooklyn incident didn't just impact the people in Brooklyn. Mm-hmm. You're talking about the young ladies that I know who are members of my church who was with the young lady who was killed. They live in Anne Arundel County. There were six kids that were shot who came from Cherry Hill. So even though all the emphasis are put in Brooklyn, what about the other areas of the city where these individuals came from who are facing that trauma as a result of being there for this block party? And you know, and where did we drop the ball at, from the police level to Safe Streets to Monsey to public housing? You know, where did we drop the ball?
You mentioned,
you know, I go back to education. You know, you people can say what they like. Where's the family? Where are families and households responsible for what's going on with our young people? I don't know how you raised your kids or if you have kids, but when my kids were home and lived with me, I knew what they brought in my house and what they didn't bring in the house, what belonged there and what didn't belong there.
You mentioned,
so we're going to get back to some basic fundamental things.
You mentioned that the murder and the crime rates were down when you were in office, significantly down compared to today. What specific policies or processes did you have under your administration that contributed to that low crime rate or murder rate?
So keep in mind, because people like to mix the zero tolerance that O'Malley had that I did not do, but that people want to accuse me of. We changed the strategy from zero tolerance, locking up people on the corners for nuisance crime. We changed that. We focused on the most violent offenders. We put a lot of emphasis on, and this is a model after Bloomberg in New York and some other cities, where we created a gun registry where if you got caught with a legal gun, you had to register with that. We tracked and followed. We went and knocked on your door, finding out what are you doing, if you're home, if you're on probation, if you're not working. We brought those resources in their face. We had the sheriff's department, school police working with us. We had a collaboration with our state and our federal representatives. We tracked this. You know, everybody's talking about data-driven. We did preventive measures where we created community schools within our schools where we looked at having partnerships with our schools and looking at the makeup of the school and what the needs were there. We created family strengthening with the League of Cities adopted, where before individuals came out of incarceration and prison, we would go in took teams of people in the women and men prisons before coming out, and we began to work with them and their families to come up with a comprehensive plan, mental health, what resources they would need when they come out. I mean, all of these pieces were working together. Safe Streets was created under my administration, not at the scale that it is now. We didn't have the money or resources there. But let's take Cherry Hill as an example. That was probably the prime area where Safe Streets was working and crime went down drastically because we worked with individuals who were part of that culture, who, and then we put them through intensive training, mental health training, to be able to navigate in the Cherry Hill community because they knew, you know, the element in their community in order to break things up before it happened. You know, those just touching on, our police officers got out of the cars like they did in the past, back in the day, to get to know the community and the neighborhood. The gun task force all end up getting out of control because, obviously, whatever reason, folks begin to not manage that. But even with the gun task force, the initial creation of it was working, getting illegal guns off the street. We had gun buybacks. So we did various things, but that was the basis of the crime plan, how we were able to get it down.
Go ahead, Tim.
With your crime plan, the makeup of a lot of the people who are doing major crimes like murders and carjackings and things of that nature are juveniles today compared to a couple years ago. Would anything have to be tweaked or added to your strategy to be more effective with your crime? If you were going to implement a crime plan like that today, would anything have to be added to cater more towards the juveniles who are committing most of the crimes?
Oh, yeah, definitely. And one of the things that I forgot to discuss is we also, during that time, had a comprehensive plan where we worked with the state. I don't remember who the secretary was of juvenile services, but we, even myself, went into on Gay Street where we began to mentor a lot of the young people who were in the juvenile center. We began, I remember the young man I was mentoring, he was trying to study for his driver's test, but then he ended up getting moved to another state. But we went in there and began to mentor them. So it would have to change a lot. But again, how do we track some of these young people? It's like the young man that was killed, in what was it, Westport, 12-year-old who had the ankle bracelet, and his grandmother was taking care of him, and he was killed. But then we also got to tweak some of the laws at the state level as well. But what could have been done early on when this guy, young man, was home on house arrest with a monitor? Where was the breakdown between juvenile justice, who was monitoring them? You know, I've been meeting with former probation officers, and one of the things that they mentioned was that now everything is computerized, so you kind of communicate by the computer. You got to be in people's faces. You got to be in their face. You got to knock on the door. You got to go there and visit them. You know, I talked to an individual who's a part of another group who got some of the squeegee guys off of the corner, because I called them myself yesterday, because now on the corner of where I live at Edmondson and Winans is four squeegee guys. And the person shared with me that the ones that they have right now, you can't lump them all in a group. He said that right now they're trying to deal with them, each one of them individually. But, you know, because some of them don't have education, cannot read, some of them have mental health issues. Some have issues in their home. You know, I've had the opportunity over the last several years, my nephew, who's a retired police officer who worked with the Bridge program in middle school when he was a police officer, even though they cut that program out. We've been working on a mental health effort initiative called Hands Across Baltimore, where we've been partnering with schools, working with therapists at the elementary level working with PRP, using sports as a way and other means to really reach our young people.
You mentioned the police back in the day when the police officers got out of the vehicles and actually tried to interact and actually become a part of the community that they were supposedly serving. And we know that under the charter, both the police commissioner and the deputy commissioner, Worley, who now has been nominated for the commissioner post, are supposed to be residents of Baltimore City. My question is, should residency or the requirement for residency be extended and expanded to include the rank and file officers, particularly since we keep hearing this thing about community trust? How do you engender community trust when the sense in the community is that you've got people coming in to manage the city from 9 to 5 and then go back home to York, Pennsylvania, or wherever they reside?
So, Robert, I have some mixed. I believe that city residency is important, but I'll be honest with you. Lately, I've had some mixed feelings about that. Yes, the department heads have to live in the city. Yes, we want to encourage our police and teachers and others to live in the city. And I know there's been different incentives to attract them to live in the city. I know the ABLE Foundation recently was working with a group in West Baltimore with buying houses, because I know right around the corner where my church is, a firefighter ended up buying a house, renovating it. So I think we need to provide all those incentives as possible. But we also have to deal with the reality of individuals and them taking care of their family. Because you don't necessarily live in that community does not mean that you can't get to know the people in that community. I have a retired officer who worked as executive protection for Smoke, who retired, who ended up being my driver, who ended up coming on my staff, and he was a foot officer who never really lived in the city. Greenmount Avenue, 33rd Street, all of that area over there was his area. He used to walk the biz strip. He used to go into the library. One of my neighbors, who was is a retired librarian, when she saw Howard at an event when we were together, not only did both of them remember each other and know each other, because he would go in the library because he likes to talk and tell stories, but those businesses, but they knew each other. This was 30, 40 years since he worked foot patrol. If we can get folks to live in the city, provide incentives, if it is reduce their property tax or whatever it takes, I'm all for that. But we also have to deal with the realities of individuals who have families and need to make choices. Particularly when the schools in that neighborhood are horrible and they have to think about their kids. And so that's why, I have some mixed feelings about that.
Speaking of property tax and the city's shrinking tax base, it's my impression, not belief yet, because I don't know what the facts are, but it's my impression that an inordinate amount of real property in Baltimore City is held by organizations that don't pay taxes, don't pay real property taxes, whether they be religious organizations or educational institutions, and that this property is really not being used for either religious or educational purposes, that in turn it's being flipped to for-profit entities who use the lack of tax liability as an economic incentive, unregulated economic incentive for the profitable enterprises. So what should the city do to at least investigate the extent to which these tax exempt property really should be paying taxes? Taxes should be collected on.
Well, many years ago, I introduced that nonprofits, religious institutions, universities, et cetera, should be paying property tax. What we came up with as a compromise is that they would pay a what's the term? They would pay a dollar amount.
Okay.
Yeah, a dollar amount to the city. I'm not even sure, to be honest with you, how much they're actually paying, and that the larger institutions would pay the bulk of that, not the religious institutions, because they're still being hit with the rain tax and some other taxes. But if those nonprofit entities have property currently that are profiting or flipping, and what you're saying, that definitely needs to be investigated. But while that's being investigated, and while they need to be paying even more, I don't even know what the dollar amount is that they're paying, or if they still even have that pilot. We also have to look at how we can provide relief to individuals who are paying high property tax. And you know that there is a movement. They're kind of quiet right now because they've taken a different approach, where there's a movement to look at reducing the property tax over the next 10 years that potentially will be on the ballot for referendum, because that's one of the reasons why people leave the city. Because we pay high property tax, we pay high insurance, we pay the cell phone tax, we pay the energy tax. We pay a lot of taxes in Baltimore.
Well, you know, the county executive in Anne Arundel County finally came clean and admitted to the Anne Arundel County residents, says, look, I need more money to cover basic services. And only way I can get that money is to raise taxes. So this mantra of no new taxes or reducing taxes, the fact of the matter is the money has to come from somewhere. And the needs keep rising. I read the other day about the collapse of the health system in Great Britain because it's been stripped and gutted of the financial support that's needed to maintain the system. And so people are now waiting inordinate amounts of time for basic health services, which shouldn't be the case. The fact of the matter is somebody's got to pay. And if you're in a jurisdiction that has needs, how are you going to cover those needs without collecting taxes from the residents, and from the residents who can't afford to pay it? Not just from, I get tired of these $40 tickets going down 83. That's my fault. But the fact of the matter is,
you should know better.
The red light tickets, the speeding tickets, the environmental control board, that's just taking money from people, for the most part, who can't afford to pay it. While the Greater Baltimore Community membership, if you will, continues to enjoy pilot programs with payment in lieu of taxes or non-payment of water bills for ages, for years and years and years, and accumulate millions of dollars in debt that nobody seems particularly anxious to try to collect.
We need to collect that. But Robert,
yes.
Anybody that goes through a school zone where there is a camera will go down 83 knowing that there's certain pockets where you need to slow down. That's a choice if you speed that you've made. And so I don't care what your income is, you got to be able to handle that. You got to have to pay the consequences on that. That's why you need to slow down in those areas.
I don't mind paying. I would like them to open an account, but the fact of the matter is the rationale for doing it obviously isn't true. Because now they've discovered that the report says that most people apparently have slowed down to the point where the revenues aren't at the level anticipated. Now they got to find money to cover the hole in the budget because the amount of revenue from speeding is less than 83 is less than what was anticipated. So what was the motive? Was it to get people to slow down or to collect the money?
But that's a mistake. The state, whoever put that bill in and whoever calculated that, they should have calculated based on trying to prevent incidents happening and not generating additional revenue. So that's their fault, whoever calculated it, and they're not getting what. But I also hear that they're not getting money because if you drive down on 83 at 6 in the morning, 6 in the morning, you see more Pennsylvania and Delaware tags. And that people in Virginia tag, the folks that are in those areas are not paying the ticket. And so we might need to look at a system like they do in D.C. Because you know if you get a ticket in D.C., I don't care where you come from, you better pay that ticket or you're going to suffer the consequences. But no, you shouldn't calculate based on what you anticipate when you're talking about safety. Same thing with school zones. That should be there in order to prevent people from speeding. Because as you know, and the rest of us, I don't know what has happened after COVID, but it's just like people are just totally impatient. I mean, it's just crazy how people are driving.
You mentioned previously that there were some laws in the state with the state legislation that should be changed that would affect Baltimore, that would help Baltimore out when it comes to crime. Were there any laws that you helped usher in during your administration with the state? And how hard was that? Because right now it seemed like in this day and time it's like pulling teeth to get any real type of crime bills passed with the state.
We did. I'll be honest with you. I can't remember what we put in place. I probably need to ask Senator Hayes, who was one of my assistant deputy mayors for public safety. But we did do some. I just can't remember what they were, to be honest with you. I'm going to make a note of that in case somebody asks me that question again and go back to Antonio and say, what were the bills that we put in at that time dealing with crime that just needs to change?
Well, I don't remember. What bills do
it's
you,
been quite a while.
What bills do you think would help Baltimore City at this point in time, whether they're already in and they should be changed or edited, or whether there's some new ones that we should usher in?
Well, not just Baltimore City, but across the state. And that's some of the gun laws that are in place, because some of the gun laws are misdemeanor. And when you carry, and I'm not talking about legal individuals who are carrying a gun or have a gun who can legally carry a gun. I'm talking about these illegal guns that are considered misdemeanors. I mean, you're carrying an illegal gun for whatever reason, and you do something with that illegal gun, I mean, you should suffer the consequences. So that's just one thing. With juveniles, I think we really need to assess, you know, not that we assess right now, if you're a juvenile and you commit a crime like the 9-year-old who took his grandmother's gun because some kids were messing with him on the basketball court, and then he went to the kid's house in Emerson Village and ended up shooting the young man, the boy's sister in the head. You know, now the grandmother is potentially going to get 6 years. Now, my question is, what happens with this 9-year-old? What have we done? What kind of resources and support is Department of Juvenile Services going to provide to this child? Or what kind of mental health services are they providing him now? So we don't get to hear any of that. I think it's important that we do. Not that you want to put their picture out there or necessarily put their name out there, but we need to know what happened as a result of that.
Carlton
Douglas wants to join in.
Okay, Carlton, you hold his name until I ask this question.
There you go.
If you want a priority, you should be here. But, Madam Mayor, what do you do with a criminal justice system where the core principle of it is that punishment results in deterrence? What do you do when the evidence is there's a bunch of folk out there who ain't deterred by the punishment because they ain't afraid to go into jail? They don't care about going to jail. Well, how do you adjust the system to relate to those individuals, particularly when there's no room in the jail for them anyway because the jail's already overcrowded? What do you do?
What, the ones who don't care if they have to go to jail?
Yeah, and or the ones that you can't send to jail because there's no beds for them. But start with the ones for whom the punishment is not a deterrent. How do you adjust, not anecdotally for those individuals, but what adjustments do you make in the system for that element that clearly is out there in the community?
Somebody texted me recently and said that their father back in the day, wherever they were raised in the South, that individuals had choices where they had to go into the military. They had to go into this program. Like, they gave them options versus going to jail. I think you even add one more thing on there. Let's send them over to some other countries to see how other people are living and see what those prisons look like and what folks have to go through in those prisons, like Nelson Mandela and others. And maybe they all have a change of heart and turn their lives around.
Okay.
That might sound a little out there, but
okay.
Or as an option, I know we're unfortunately introducing a lot of adult materials to children younger and younger in high school, in elementary school and middle school. When do we start introducing to children what the prison system looks like? Because a lot of people in legislations are saying, you know, the kids don't know. They don't know. They don't know that ABC will equal D, right? So when do we start saying, this is what a jail looks like. This is what your life looks like behind a jail. This is what a detention center look like. If you do this, these are what the consequences are going to be. When do we start introducing that to our children, you know, in public
school? The same way that we introduce, the same way some folks introduce kids early on to rap music, to playing R-rated Xbox and PlayStation games at 4 or 5 years old. I think we need to start introducing, you know, letting them see R-rated movies. I remember my kids could not see R-rated movies or PG-13 movies. Now, their aunt used to sneak them and let them see R-rated movies, but I didn't. I was extremely, same thing with the Xbox games and stuff. You know, when my son would let his father buy it because he didn't realize that it was rated, and then I would have to have them take the games back. So as soon as, let's do it early. Do it early. Kids expose us so much at an early age.
Right, and I think we need to expose them to the consequences. They see it, but I don't think they see the consequences. Like, I know even if a kid is in elementary school, I mean, do they know that people get raped in jail? And I'm sure if they have family members who go to jail, they're not going to come home and say, man, that was a bad experience. I was raped. You know what I'm saying? So they really may not have the comprehension of what jail is going to be like. So jail is not a deterrence to them because they have people who go and people who come home and everything seems fine and fun and gravy.
Well, maybe we need to have individuals come in our school and speak to our kids and share that.
I would agree.
And you know, that information, you know, Scared Straight, you know, it has been done where you took kids to the prison and all that, but literally have folks come and talk to them at even an early age and say, hey, this is what happened to me, and this is the consequences that happened.
Okay. Good morning to everyone.
Good morning, Mr. Undertaker.
First of all, I didn't know I had to, I didn't ask for priority, and I didn't know I had to be there to be priority. Mm. But anyway, Madam Mayor, thank you for coming on the Frank M. Conaway Senior at Al Show. I got a couple questions for you because I've got to get off. I'm on a service, but I'll be calling back at 11. And I don't know if I may sound rhetorical because some of these things may have already been talked about. One of the things is the Motsi organization that handles Safe Streets. Have you talked about that yet?
No.
Okay, my question is, did this start under your regime or who? And if it didn't, what was the original intent of Monty over the Safe Streets organization? And what exactly is the description of the Safe Street? Because now there's a controversy going on concerning two council persons, Yitzi, and I forgot who the other white council person is, being accused by the former head of Monty, Ms. Shante Jackson, of being racist. So,
I hadn't heard that. I haven't heard that.
Yeah, that's the hottest thing that's out right now. I listened to it on some other shows this morning. And I was wondering if you could give us some insight concerning the organization Monty itself and Safe Street itself, because a lot of questions being asked about Safe Streets that nobody seems to want to answer.
So Safe Streets was established under my administration, and it was modeled after ceasefire in Chicago. And actually, Senator Hayes, Antonio, who was the deputy mayor for public safety, went to Chicago, saw this effort working. We brought it back here. We started in Cherry Hill and two other locations, East Baltimore, and I can't remember the third location. We didn't have the money they have now. Monty did not exist. We, through the health department, contracted out with Living Classroom, and the gentleman that ran this is deceased, but I can't think of his name this minute, but He used to be a part of that culture. And so the purpose is to find and identify individuals from those communities that will be who are part of that culture, who can go in the community and really kind of squash incidents before it happens, and because they can relate and they know the individuals in that community. And they do it in a way that they don't go to the police. They report the information to and Cherry Hill used to be the community family center, where they would report that, and then the community family center would then in turn have communication with the police department. But in Cherry Hill, it used to be very successful. Monty is very new. I think it got created. I think it's been created under the Brandon administration, if my memory serves me correct. Only a couple years ago. Before that, we had the Criminal Coordinating Council, where a lot of our funding, where we would seek out funding for public safety, for programming, that would then disperse money, and ours was through the health department. I'm not aware about this, Monty being racist or Shante Jackson being racist and why they're accusing her of that. I do know
The organization. No, Shante is accusing Yitzy and another one of the white council persons for being racist for asking the questions that they're asking about safety. I didn't say Shante was
wrong. Oh, well, I think the question, because they're not the only ones that asked the question. It was Antonio Glover, and I discussed it this morning on Fox. I think that the questions that were being asked in reference to Brooklyn, and I actually did some research to some former State Street people in Cherry Hill, straight up and asked them, how is this being run now versus how it used to be run? And who do they respond to? Who do they answer to? Now, and why is Catholic Charity overseeing Safe Street? What's their expertise in this area? So the information I got is that some of the Safe Street individuals were part of the Brooklyn Festival, like helped to contribute to the Brooklyn Festival. But when they broke up some incidents that happened, they then report to Catholic Charity, and Catholic Charities is supposed to report to Monty. So where did the breakdown? If they report to Catholic Charity and Catholic Charity report to Monty about this big event going on out here and potentially need folks out there, I guess we'll find out where the breakdown came out. The other issue is, like the former safety person told me, if something was going on, you ain't on a ship where you leave at a certain time. You stay out there and you try to mitigate what you can to make sure that things are going well and that nobody's getting out of control. So they were asked a legitimate question. It seems like for some reason, not giving up the names of the employees who work for Safe Street, I understand that, but the communication of who talks to who and how does information get to the next step and how is this money being managed, I think is a fair question to ask.
My other question is this. The Baltimore City chapter, and full disclosure here, I am a member of the executive committee of the Baltimore City branch of the NAACP. They have come out wanting a national search for a commissioner of police. I don't believe a national search is necessary because we need a police commissioner now. However, and I do agree with it ought to be someone from this area that knows the police department. What is your opinion about the NAACP demanding a national search for the next commissioner of police for Baltimore City?
To be honest with you, I personally think that, and Commissioner Harrison, whose contract would have ended in, March? Mm-hmm. I think that we should have consistency. He's been there 5 years. He's made changes with the consent decree. I mean, it's not like I'm like pushing for him and not Wally, because I don't know Wally. He was like a lieutenant when I was mayor, so I don't really know him. I talk to other people to ask them about him. But I think we should have finished out the commissioner's contract and then assessed whether or not to do a national search or to have somebody locally. That's just my opinion.
Thank you, guys. I'll be back with you after 11. Thanks so much.
Thank you. Going back to safe streets, how do you determine the efficiency of it? Because if it was modeled after a ceasefire in Chicago, we know Chicago murder rate is still going up and up and up. And safe streets, we still, over the last couple of years, we still had over 300 murders. So what is the best way to determine whether or not safe streets is working in terms of curbing the murders?
All you can do is go by, and again, I'm not in there, so I can't see what things have happened with those workers to deter things from, you know, from an incident happened where somebody was being killed. But whatever information that they're providing, it's important to do an assessment of that to see whether or not it's working or not.
When you started it, how would you have assessed it? Like, from the conception of it, the evaluation process?
Well, we assessed. We had some challenges, but we did an assessment. And I go back to Cherry Hill. Cherry Hill was a prime example of how successful it was. Crime went down almost to no murders in a year. I mean, crime had gone down consistently in Cherry Hill for a number of years, and that helped based on those who were working with Safe Streets, as well as the police department. I mean, so, you know, we had our assessment process. We knew, but I don't know what they use today, to be honest with you. I just don't know.
So murders going down.
We got a lot of money, know that much.
So murders going down is a good assessment to at least begin with.
That, and if you can break up, if there's a feud between gangs and you were able to reassess, you know, you can break that up. If you're able to navigate a situation where it doesn't end up being a killing or a shooting, where you could bring two sides, if there's a disagreement together, that's another indicator. That information, though, has to be documented, too.
Well, it's always been difficult to prove a negative. And it's always easy to say, well, if it hadn't been for this, the murder rate would have been 400 or 500. And we stopped, you know, is a measure of the effectiveness of the totality of everything that's being done, the holistic approach, isn't the only real measurement of that is how safe the people in the community feel and how easy how they're able to go about their daily lives without fear of carjacking or hijacking or whatever it may be. Isn't that really the only real anything short of that is just going for snapshots or headlines, when in reality it either is a whole list, either everything is working together to produce the outcome, or maybe nothing individually is working. You understand what I'm trying to say?
Well, that's the biggest thing. Yeah, I got you. That's the biggest thing. People feeling safe in their community.
Yeah.
And at that time, for a number of years in Cherry Hill, people did begin to feel safe. And people did feel that, because, you know, there's a lot of public housing in Cherry Hill. People felt that they could get out, they could do their festivals, they could sit out on their steps or stoops or in their backyard and feel safe and know that they didn't have to all constantly look behind their back.
And so we don't really know. And we don't really know whether that's attributable
to. Well, we don't
really know whether that's attributable to solely to safe streets or the combination of safe streets and police community policing as was in effect at the time. And does it really matter as long as the outcome is positive and people feel better? It's like going to the. It's like a medical condition. You know, if the pill works, do we really need to know what's in it?
Yeah, I want to know if it's a pill.
Maybe that's not a particularly good analogy, but yeah, I think you get the point.
Yeah, I get the point, but all of those pieces contributed to
that's right.
To the Cherry Hill, all of those pieces.
That's right.
But again, you got to be transparent about those things all working, because don't try to get money. You know, it's like nonprofits, in order to survive their budget, to meet their payroll, they're going to try to get money wherever and however they can, but they're not producing real results, the kind of results that they need to, like Catholic Charity, not to pick on them, but, you know, they deal with homelessness, they deal with all of these other factors. What's the expertise in dealing with crime and safety?
On this show, we've interviewed senators, city council people, and just to figure out what role they play in government and actually what power do they have to make the changes that are necessary specifically for Baltimore City. And it's been said that the mayor has dominating power, you know, compared to other cities throughout the country. The mayor has dominating power where there are few checks and balances that are placed on him by any city council or any agency. Do you think that is true, a true statement?
No, Baltimore City is a mayor-controlled city because of Board of Estimates and others, but that does not preclude a council person. And now council even have more power than they had in the past because they can take money, not only cut it, but they can move money. So they actually have more power, and the veto number now has changed. So they have a lot more power than in the past. It's all in how you understand and use it. So that whole conversation about because the mayor has it, because there are things that you can do. Keep in mind, I was a city council person. I was council president. I was the chair of the Board of Estimates. And on many occasions, I try to explain this to Bill Henry and Nick D'Adamo. Because Bill Henry's the secretary. I'm not Nick D'Adamo. That's only because I was just with him recently. Nick Mosby is the president.
Right.
I used deferred on a lot of stuff until I got what I needed, not for me personally, but for my constituents or, you know, in the city. You know, those like pilots and tips and things like that, they knew, BDC knew not to bring nothing to me unless it had certain elements in it before we could introduce it. Or we get deferred. So it's all in how you use what power you do have. Or if it's legislation. Okay, the administration introduces legislation. Okay, well, we want to see this happen, Mr. Mayor or Ms. Mayor. So until I can get X, Y, and Z or see such and such, this bill ain't coming out.
We know that the mayor, well, the commissioner serves at the pleasure of the mayor. How about the superintendent of the education school board? What power does the mayor really have with the superintendent and the school board?
So the mayor appoints, with the exception of the two now elected school board members, the mayor appoints the school board.
The entire school board, or how many?
No, except for two.
Okay.
So what is it? Is 11 on there or 9, whatever the number is?
I think it's 11.
So with the exception of the student representative. So the school board hires the CEO. Well, if the mayor appoints 9 of the 11 and they hire the CEO, you tell me. The mayor has a lot of power on the CEO. On top of the fact that the city has to provide maintenance of effort money to the schools. And even though the school system is a separate entity now, we still have to contribute $50 to now $79 million that has to go before the council. So not having involvement and engagement because it's separate, that's bull. I always was active and involved in the school system.
And we have a question from one of our listeners. Since you are in favor of recruiting police officers, whether they live in the city or they live in another state, long as they can come and do their job, what would you do to help recruit police officers from wherever they might be willing to serve from?
Well, two things that we did, and unfortunately, the Rollins-Blake administration got rid of it. We created an academy for fire, police, and paramedics in the school system. At that time, it was at, I still call it Walbrook. We had an academy where we were trying to attract our young people within Baltimore City Public Schools to look at public safety, fire, EMS as a profession, to really show them that there are many things that you can do within the police department. And I definitely believe, and that's how you get young people who live in your city to potentially be a firefighter or a police officer or a paramedic or even one of the other type of positions that the police department has, forensic or whatever. So that academy, I think today it probably would have taken off if we had continued with that academy. Number two, we recruited. We did a big recruitment out of Puerto Rico. We have a large Hispanic and Latino population. So we did recruitment. Some counties and other places now are providing other incentives by increasing salaries. But you got to constantly, and you got to, before somebody leaves, first of all, you got to talk to your folks from the bottom up. You know, that guy on the street, you want his input. So before they put in those papers or they're looking at putting their papers and they're leaving, you want to have a conversation with them. Why are you leaving? You know, what are your reasons for leaving? What is it that we could do to retain you because of your experience? So you have to constantly
talk. You're not allowed to sit in the car and talk.
Yeah, okay, thank you. No.
I'm kidding.
I know.
Madam Mayor?
You too, sir. No, I was going to interview. Somebody was talking to me.
No problem. And because of the clock, I got to ask you, closing out, how close are we to Sheila Dixon making an announcement? How close are we?
We're close. That's all I have to say. We're
close. Thank you so very much. Appreciate you giving us the time you did.
Thanks for having me. Bob Dashiell was bugging me to come on, and I appreciate it.
And we do, too. Thank you much.
Talk in the day. Soul at night.